Hi everyone, thanks very much for joining me. So in this video I want to just give a quick recap of some of the films I watched in June. But before I do that, it's 30th of June and we got the news today that Alan Arkin passed away. So I just wanted to recognise that. A really great actor in main roles, but also perhaps in more latter years in supporting roles. He obviously won that Oscar for his role in Little Miss Sunshine and was Oscar nominated for his role in the film Argo. Earlier in his career in films such as The Russians Are Coming and Inspector Clouseau and films like that, he had a real hyperness to his acting style, but then also when he progressed into sort of more character roles, if it was a comedy, then there was a real sort of drollness to his humour and a real twinkle in his eye when he was delivering his lines. Or if it was dramatic, then there was a very sort of emphaticness to his delivery, which made him really good in films such as Argo and Glengarry Glen Ross and things like that. This is him also in The In-Laws that he starred in with Peter Falk. But the film perhaps that I think of straight away when I think of Alan Arkin is this wonderful film from 1967, Wait Until Dark, in which he starred alongside Audrey Hepburn. Really nice thriller, this one, directed by Terence Young. Audrey Hepburn as a blind woman who's being terrorised in her apartment by psychopathic killer here, Alan Arkin, who is convinced that she mistakenly has a doll in her apartment that is stuffed full of heroin. It's a really, really atmospheric and tense kind of thriller, a really enjoyable one. And I love his performance in that. Both of them are very good in this. So yeah, sad news today that we lost Alan Arkin. Blue Car is a film that's directed and written by Karen Moncrief. This film is actually going to be released by Imprint Films in August, so you may want to look out for that. Now, this cover perhaps suggests something a bit Lolita-ish, and the film itself in the blurb on the marketing here kind of describes itself as being a bit in the vein of American Beauty. And I think both this cover and that description is misleading. It's not really quite like that, although there is, an inappropriate relationship that's in this film. But essentially, this is really a coming-of-age drama, and whereas American Beauty obviously was focused much more on the male character of Kevin Spacey going through a midlife crisis and then getting involved with a younger girl, here we have a young woman who is in a difficult situation where she's got parents who have separated. She doesn't get to see her dad much, and her mother is neglectful and bitter and angry. So meanwhile, the girl herself, played by Agnes Bruckner, she enjoys writing poetry and gets encouraged by her tutor at school, who's played by David Strathairn, to enter a poetry competition. And that encouragement gradually leads to a more in-depth kind of relationship, if you like. There is some uncomfortable moments in this one as that relationship gets a little bit more intense as the film progresses, but I wouldn't call this a film that's quite like American Beauty. It's a much different kind of thing to that. Definitely an interesting film. This was Karen Moncrief's first film as a writer-director. She's also directed a film with Kate Beckinsale called The Trials of Kate McCall, and has done a fair bit of TV work as well. This is really noteworthy for Agnes Bruckner's performance in this. She's really, really good, and David Strathairn is always reliable. You can always depend on him in all pretty much any role that he plays, so he's very, very good. The writing is a little bit, I was going to say weak at times, but that's really because of some of the budgetary constraints that they had, so there's a little bit of disjointedness to some of the scenes, director Karen Moncrief actually talks about some of that on the commentary, and so there's an element of some oversights on her part, but also some things which were just budgetary constraints. But nonetheless, this is still a really interesting film. It is a really, really good performance from Agnes Bruckner. David Strathairn, excellent as always. Worth seeing. So perhaps keep an eye out for this one on its release from Imprint Films. Kiss of Death. This is a great film noir from 1947 that stars Victor Mature. In this one, Victor Mature is a kind of small-time thief, jewelry thief, wanting to sort of steal so that he can provide for his daughters. But he gets caught in the act and gets shot and arrested and put into prison. He tries to play it hard and not want to give up his colleagues, so he, you know, he's determined to do his time, but then things change when he finds out that his wife has committed suicide whilst he's in prison, so that makes his attitude change and he becomes more compliant in wanting to cooperate with the police. But in doing so, he gives up a name and activities of a vicious criminal that's played by Richard Widmark in his very first role, which won him an Oscar. Things progress quite nastily when things backfire and Richard Widmark's character comes gunning for Victor Mature. This is a terrific film. Definitely, what's interesting is that a lot of it is filmed on actual locations. In one of my earlier videos, you have seen me, or you may have seen me, talk about reasons to see Sing Sing Thanksgiving, which is a really neglected documentary concert film that was filmed in Sing Sing prison. Now, another reason to see Sing Sing Thanksgiving is also because Kiss of Death had scenes filmed there. So again, you get this fascinating look inside that very interesting prison, as well as other great locations in the film. But the real knockout in this film for sure is Richard Widmark. His performance, considering this is his first on-screen performance and it won him an Oscar, he's incredible in this. I mean, Victor Mature is the main star and he's a formidable presence, but Richard Widmark really steals the scenes. He's got this sort of maniacal laugh and grin, and he has some very, very vicious behavior as well. It's fantastically photographed, really, really intense at times. I mean, some of the dramatic scenes obviously have mellowed over the years, but this is still a great watch. I really, really enjoyed this one. Something Wicked This Way Comes is a superbly ghostly and atmospheric kind of tale that's an adaptation of a Ray Bradbury novel. And this is a Walt Disney film, and you really wouldn't think it. It's really quite strong in places, I guess, for a Walt Disney film. Quite scary. It has absolutely the best use of tarantulas that I've ever seen in a film. And I think if I'd seen this as a kid, I would still be having nightmares. Marvelous performances from Jonathan Pryce. And we've got a really unexpected turn from Pam Grier, Jackie Brown, in this. And she looks amazing, really stunning. This is definitely one to watch. It's directed by Jack Clayton, who's definitely got experience with doing ghostly tales, because he also did The Innocents, which you can get through Criterion. And in fact, any of you who are looking at the Criterion sale right now through Barnes & Noble, definitely pick up a copy of The Innocents. It's superb. Really enjoyed Something Wicked This Way Comes. It has some excellent practical effects as well. And look at this tremendous makeup that they had Jonathan Pryce go through. Really incredible stuff. So yeah, can you believe this is a Disney film? Wow. And I finally got around to watching The Tourist with Johnny Depp and Angelina Jolie. This is directed by Florian Henkel von Donnersmarck, and it was his follow-up film to this one, The Lives of Others. And such a strange follow-up movie to come to America and do this type of movie. I really find it quite bizarre, but nonetheless, yeah, this was actually more enjoyable than I was thinking it was going to be, but definitely more in the vein of it just being a sit back and enjoy the location kind of movie, because a lot of this is filmed in and around Venice, and there's some really great cinematography, like I say, you just really get to explore a lot of the city. So from that point of view, I was entertained and had a good time with it. And similarly, Friends with Benefits, this is one that also benefits from just having locations that are enjoyable to watch. So I really love New York. A lot of this is filmed in and around New York, and so locations that I have been to. So from that point of view, I enjoyed watching this. The comedy itself is fairly forgettable, but I like the performances. Justin Timberlake and Mila Kunis, they're both pretty good in this. I've liked Justin Timberlake before. I've seen him in concert a couple of times. I've liked some of his previous movies. I think he's perfectly fine. But yeah, it's great to know that I have actually sat on the same rock in Central Park as Mila Kunis. Wow. Honey Dripper is a great movie from John Sayles, and it's set in the 50s in Alabama, and we've got a superb performance from Danny Glover in this as a bar owner who's in debt and in difficulty, and so needs to shake things up, and so he decides with his partner, and also really good performance from Charles S. Dutton, to try and get a blues guitarist to come to town to play in their club and bring back the crowds. I enjoyed this one. It's a very leisurely paced drama, but John Sayles just spends time developing all the different characters that you have here. This was just a good hangout kind of movie in that respect. And he gets a really good period flavour as well. Because this is blues based as well, we get some really wonderful performances. There's a performance at the very beginning of the film from a lady, I think her name is Mabel John, and she's sadly passed away now, and I think this was her only film role, but she gets to sing old-fashioned blues at the beginning of the film, and it's really wonderful to watch her. Then the film develops, and we're obviously then having to get into a sort of newer style of blues to attract the audiences. And this is where it gets interesting, because Gary Clark Jr. Plays the guitarist that they end up getting. An actual musician. I've seen Gary Clark Jr. in concert. He gives a surprisingly nice performance here. He's got a very sort of nice character to him. We have to wait a while to actually get to see him play, but that build up is worth it. And there's also another great musician in the film as well, Keb Moe, who plays this kind of blind blues guitarist who offers words of wisdom on the street corner, and he's terrific as well. Very leisurely paced, takes its time, fantastic performances, and a really, really, really great performance from Danny Glover. And on Tubi, I watched The Offence from 1973, which stars Sean Connery, and it's directed by Sidney Lumet. Really interesting film, this one. And it's made at a time when Connery was kind of done with Bond and wanting to establish himself again as a more dramatic actor. And wow, is he giving a dramatic performance in this film. He plays a cop who's a homicide detective who's really worn down, I guess, by all his years of investigations, and is at cracking point when he manages to capture a child killer who's played by Ian Bannon, and a really great performance from Ian Bannon as well. His superior is played by Trevor Howard, also a terrific performance. So the three of them, as they play out this drama, mostly in cell rooms, is really, really intense. Terrific, terrific performances. Definitely a highlight of Sean Connery's career, and definitely a worthwhile watch. And you may have seen in one of my previous haul videos that I mentioned that I picked up Caliber 9, which was a Fernando de Leo movie, and won the first part of a trilogy of movies. And just coincidentally, the other movies were on the Criterion channel, so The Italian Connection and The Boss. So I was able to watch those. All three of those movies, they all follow a similar kind of format, in that you have a very violent opening scene before the titles, the sort of mob police drama that then plays out, interspersed with some great action scenes. There's a lot of Italian sort of corruption that's going on, and a lot of talk involved in all of these films in terms of who's really at fault, the rich or the poor or the police or the politicians, so there's a lot of finger pointing and blaming of each other. So yeah, a lot of discussion in these films, but also some great action sequences as well. And then when I watched those, there was also another one on the Criterion channel called Shoot First, Die Later. And when I was watching that one, there's a terrific car chase that's in that one. And I was just watching closely, and there's a sequence, and I'll just try and show you the clip if I can, where during the car chase, another car is forced off the road and it dives into a canal. And as I was watching it, I could see that there was actually the stunt driver still inside this car, desperately trying to get out of the car before it got submerged in the canal. So yeah, incredible stuff that they were doing back in the 70s, which I'm sure not even Tom Cruise would do nowadays. And also this month, I was watching some movies by the director Sidney J. Fury. I have done a video already on those films, so if you haven't seen that, then can I please ask you go and check it out, because I do talk in that video about some movies which really don't get so much attention. Those films include The Snake Woman, The Boys, and The Leather Boys, and those two films in particular are very interesting ones. But yeah, that pretty much wraps things up for this month. So please let me know your comments. Have you seen any of the films that I've just been talking about? What do you think? And please do come back for some more videos. Please like and subscribe if you've enjoyed this, and I hope I will see you again. All the best to you. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.